السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله ولتنظر نفس ما قدمت لغد واتقوا الله إن الله خبير بما تعملون. ولا تكونوا كالذين نسوا الله فأنساهم أنفسهم أولئك هم الفاسقون. لا يستوي أصحاب النار وأصحاب الجنة أصحاب الجنة هم الفائزون. لو أنزلنا هذا القرآن على جبل لرأيته خاشعا متصدعا من خشية الله. وتلك الأمثال نضربها للناس لعلهم يتفكرون. هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو عالم الغيب والشهادة هو الرحمن الرحيم. هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الملك القدوس السلام المؤمن المهيمن العزيز الجبار المتكبر. سبحان الله عما يشركون. هو الله الخالق البارئ المصور. هو الله الخالق البارئ المصور له الأسماء الحسنى. يسبح له ما في السماوات والأرض وهو العزيز الحكيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله وحده وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على من لا نبي بعده وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his entire household, all his companions. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless every single one of them, for indeed they have struggled and they have striven, they have strived at a time when it was needed most in order to preserve, protect the deen, and to convey it in such a way that today it has got to us. May Allah bless us all and those in the chain who brought the deen down to us, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala use us to convey this deen in a beautiful way to the next generations, in a way that when they pray, they will pray for us too. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all forgiveness and goodness, and may He bless every single one of us, and may He bless our offspring to come up to the day of judgment. May He grant them steadfastness and us too. Ameen. My brothers and sisters, the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they were known as Sahabatu Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They were not known as his friends or colleagues. They were not known as acquaintances. They were known as companions. Because companionship is very different. It is a much more intimate relation with a lot of respect and with much more in terms of learning and with a greater impact than a person who is perhaps a mere accomplice or perhaps an acquaintance. A person who is a friend sometimes can have a negative impact on his friend, and this is why we are taught, يُعْرَفُ الْمَرْءُ بِخَلِيلِهِ فَلْيَنْظُرْ أَحَدُكُمْ مَنْ يُخَالِلْ. A person is known by the friends he or she keeps. So each one of you should be careful whom you befriend. Watch out whom your friends are. Their habits brush off onto yours. And if you are the stronger of the two, yours will brush off onto whoever it is. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us positive friends who have a positive impact on those who are our own friends. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala let them have a positive impact on us too. But going to companionship, one who has spent some time with Muhammad in between, amazing. This is a companion of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Do you know that the moment that they spent with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the moment they saw him, they earned a rank whereby whenever we mention their name, it would be disrespectful not to add radiyallahu anhu to that name, no matter what has happened thereafter, because we do know that there have been a few disputes and disagreements amongst some of the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum, but for us, they are known as radiyallahu anhum. May Allah's peace be upon them. May Allah be happy with them. May Allah be pleased with them. May He be pleased with us too. Ameen. This is the respect that we show that category of people who are chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as the best to tread this earth after the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if I were to ask you a simple question, who is the best to tread this earth ever? The correct answer would be Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, without a speck of doubt. We believe in that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to understand the seriousness of that statement. And then if I were to ask you, and after him, we would have to say the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And after them, the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the top of them being Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu, whose name was Abdullah ibn Uthman radiyallahu anhu. This was his name, and he was known fondly as Abu Bakr, that is a kunya, Abu Bakr radiyallahu anhu. But if you were to know his proper name, as he was named by his parents, he was known as Abdullah, and his father was also known as Abu Quhafa, and his name was Uthman. So Abdullah ibn Uthman, that was the name of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu, afdalu man masha ala al-ardi ba'da al-anbiya. Without a doubt, he was the best of the lot who tread this earth after the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So don't let anyone confuse you. Today we have scholars of Islam in our midst. And the reality is, there is some form of an agenda to tarnish the images of the scholars of the deen, so that we who are following, we become lost sheep who don't know where to go. This is something dangerous. When we lack leadership, then we become a lost flock because we don't have the leadership. But the reality is, when we have the leadership and people are tarnishing the image of those who are supposed to be leading us in a way that we become so disrespectful with them that we do not want to hear anything they have to say, who will then lead us besides the wolf himself? This is a very important point. And for this reason, it is disrespectful not to say radiyallahu anhu, no matter what had happened. Allahu Akbar. And this is why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam makes it clear. He says, لا تسبوا أصحابي فوالذي نفسي بيده لو أنفق أحدكم مثل أحد ذهب ما بلغ مد أحدهم ولا نصيفه. Don't you dare speak ill about any one of my companions. For indeed, if you were to spend the Mount Uhud's weight worth of gold in the path of Allah, it would not be equivalent to even one handful or half a handful of what they had spent. Because at that time, it was much more needed. It was a totally different situation. It was right at the beginning when what we would term the iron was hot. And you know, the molding was done at that particular time. Wallahi, if we go through the sacrifices of those companions, we will come to learn that had it not been for that sacrifice, today we would not be seated in our thousands in this beautiful house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So don't they deserve some form of credit and respect? Don't we deserve to be silent regarding some of the disputes that may have taken place between them? Sometimes we hear of the disputes between Muawiyah radiallahu anhu and the children of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhum. May Allah's peace and blessings be upon all of them. And we become big judges and big champions in that. And we start saying this man was cursed and that man was this and this one was the other one. Yet Muawiyah radiyallahu anhu was one of those who also was selected to write part of the wahi, part of the revelation. So once we start swearing and cursing him, what will happen? We begin to doubt revelation. A'udhu billah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from the devil and from his plan. So it is extremely important for us to know the reasoning behind Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's instruction to us to respect the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One of these reasons is because your entire deen has come through them. They have sacrificed. If we are to discount their effort and disrespect them, we begin to lose respect for the deen itself. Some people begin to curse the status of the young companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, such as Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, and they begin to issue remarks that are very derogatory by saying, oh, he was only with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for a very short period of time. How can he have narrated so many hadith? Allah grants barakah to whomsoever he wishes. Sometimes the youngest from amongst us has memorized the Quran much stronger than the older ones from amongst us. It is the choice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some of our children have made a greater effort in learning the deen than some of the older ones. And sometimes it's the blessings given by Allah, the ability given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we say Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, we need to know that his proper name was Abdul Rahman ibn Sakhr. And we also need to know that we will say radiallahu anhu. And we also need to know that the bulk of the hadith and the sayings and the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came via that particular companion when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had made a dua for him, and when he was a person who really made a great effort in conveying the message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So don't let anyone allow you, or do not let anyone con you into believing that we are allowed to speak bad about this companion and that one and this one. Because if that is the case, we lose the value of the deen. And this is why, when it comes to Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, we find some people bad-mouthing him, na'udhu billah. Whereas the hadith of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, do you know what he says? He says, if Umar ibn al-Khattab was walking down a certain gully or alley, shaitan would never walk down the same gully or alley, but he would walk down a different one. And another narration says that if there were to be a messenger after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, perhaps it would have been the likes of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. The reason is, many times he utters statements in his life which were later confirmed by the revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sometimes he uttered certain words, and when he was asked for advice, sometimes he gave certain advice. And later on, the Quran came to confirm the opinion of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's peace and blessings be upon all of them. My brothers and sisters, what a powerful topic. What powerful people. We have no standing in front of them. We are only known because we have taken from their teachings. Today, if we were to remove the teachings of the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we would have no Quran in our midst. We would have nothing to talk about. We wouldn't even be gathered here. You would not even know me, nor would I have an inclination of who you were. Subhanallah. But it is because of their sacrifice and Allah having chosen them that the message has come down. Let us look at some of what they have done. Let me start off with a certain man, great man, a noble man, a man who was downtrodden before he accepted Islam. And after he accepted Islam, he was one of those who called towards Salah. And he received the reward of everyone who read Salah after the call. And this is why Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, لَوْ يَعْلَمُ النَّاسُ مَا فِي النِّدَاءِ وَالصَّفِّ الْأَوَّلِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَجِدُوا إِلَّا أَنْ يَسْتَهِمُوا عَلَيْهِ لَاسْتَهَمُوا. Amazing. If people knew the value of the call towards prayer and of the first saf, the first row when it comes to prayer, and they would get there by any and every means, even if it meant that they had to draw a lot in order to decide who's going to be there, they would have done that. One narration says, وَلَوْ يَعْلَمُونَ مَا فِي التَّهْجِيرِ لَاسْتَبَقُوا إِلَيْهِ وَلَوْ يَعْلَمُونَ مَا فِي الْعَتَمَةِ وَالصُّبْحِ لَأَتَوْهُمَا وَلَوْ حَبْوَى. If they knew the value and the reward of the night prayer, the late night prayer and the early morning prayer, they would come to it even if it meant crawling. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Imagine, today we've lost value of adhan. When you see a muadhin, you think, oh, by the way, this is the muadhin calling out to adhan. In some countries, they call him with a derogatory term because they say this is the muadhin. Whereas the hadith of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the most conspicuous people on the day of judgment shall be those who called out the adhan. And those who did so constantly and continuously. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us and accept us. So here is Bilal ibn Rabah. He was an Abyssinian slave, dark man from Africa, who had no value before Islam. He was owned by Umayyah ibn Khalaf, one of the elites of Quraysh, and he was maltreated so badly. But when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's message was brought forth to him, immediately he accepted the message. And he faced challenges, and he faced persecution as a result. But he never gave in, never caved, not once. He continued whilst he was being dragged through the hot desert sand and through the rocks that were placed on his own chest. In the heat of the day, he kept on saying, Ahadun Ahad, Ahadun Ahad. I only believe in one Allah. I will worship only my Maker, one alone. No one else. And they punished him. They told him, you just remain silent and we will stop. He chose not even to be silent. I will continue with what I am saying. Why? This went down in history and the lesson has come to us. And from this, it is the test of Allah that anyone who turns to the deen shall be challenged somehow by those who don't want him or her there, whether it is a family member, community member, or anyone else. If you want to come closer to Allah, it will not be free. It will not be cheap. It will be at a payment of what? Some form of a sacrifice. Some of us are lucky. We are born Muslimin. There is still a sacrifice in order to get up for Salatul Fajr. Are you ready to make that sacrifice? Nobody is putting some hot rock on your chest and dragging you through the hot desert sand, which perhaps is more than 60, 70 degrees to say the least, which is burning you. They are only saying, just get up for Salatul Fajr. Subhanallah. The same caller who was the original caller of the adhan sacrificed in a bigger way. Why don't you just listen to that same call? As-salatu khayrun minan nawm. Wow. I'm sure we've heard that so many times. But what happens? The difficulty is, those who have made the clock have created a button known as snooze. Snooze is the disaster. You want to snooze, you lose. Allahu Akbar, remember that. If you snooze, you lose. Allahu Akbar. So don't snooze it. Put your clock far away. Let it ring as loud as possible. So you and the whole household get up. And when you get up, you have to walk a distance of a few meters before you turn off the clock. And subhanallah, if you want still to behave in a even better manner and an example for the rest of your family, let the clock keep ringing until you have completed your wudu. Then go and turn it off. Subhanallah. I hope we don't create disasters in our own homes where people say, who do you think you are? I need to sleep. Allahu Akbar. We are Muslimin. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to learn from the sacrifice of the Sahaba. Why do you think we're talking about it this afternoon? One of the main reasons is for us to draw lesson. For us to understand and realize that what is being asked of us is nothing compared to what was asked of them. Take a look at Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, coming up with 100% of whatever he owned when it came to the expedition of Tabuk. And what did he do? He didn't even bat an eyelid. They asked him, what have you left behind? He says, I've left Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If I were to ask you, my brothers, 100% of what you own, let's give it forth for the sake of the deen. You know what might happen? You will find a fault with the cause that you are trying to be called towards giving to. And you'll say, but that guy is a little bit shady. There is no transparency in that organization. And this is happening, you know, this something. Why? Because we don't want to give. Allahu Akbar. Sometimes shaitan comes to us to say, don't give. But you are not even being asked of 10%. You are being asked of 2.5%. Not of your wealth, but of the wealth that Allah has given you. Allahu Akbar. And we still feel like we want to hold back. And sometimes we have enough for generations to live by. Yet we cannot even give the generation that is living in our midst now that is in desperate need of something Allah has given me. With those people Allah says, للفقراء المهاجرين الذين أخرجوا من ديارهم وأموالهم يبتغون فضلا من الله ورضوانا وينصرون الله ورسوله أولئك هم الصادقون. I will translate that starting from the end of the verse where Allah says, those are the truthful ones. Those are the ones who are truthful. Who is truthful? Imagine when Allah is saying you are true to your iman. Allah is saying that you are true to your claim of belief. It means He has tested you through and through and you have passed the test. Allahu Akbar. So what type of people were these? Allah says those were the truthful. Who were the truthful? Those who believed in Allah, they were poor because they were driven out of their homes only because they accepted the deen and they did not embrace the worldly material items that were being taken away from them as a result, but rather they embraced the deen, they embraced Allah and His messenger. When they were driven out, they left with their deen, they went elsewhere. And Allah says they were the truthful when they said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Immediately they meant it completely from the bottom of their hearts. They lived by it and they sacrificed for it in a very big way. What are we ready to sacrifice? Allah says those poor muhajireen, those who were driven out of Makkah, who were driven out of their own homes, and they were driven out of where their wealth was. The wealth was usurped from them solely to earn the pleasure of Allah. They are looking forth to the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the happiness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in order to help Allah and His Messenger, meaning for the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah says those are the truthful. Muhajireen, they came through. Today if we were to tell you here that there are maybe 4,000 or 5,000 people, and there are another 4,000 or 5,000 people outside. Each one of us needs to take one to our home and look after them for another 10 years. What would happen? It would need a heart made of gold to do that. It would need a heart made of gold. We cannot get along with our own parents anymore. Your wife and husband whom Allah has selected for you, you've had children together, you're not ready to live together. So what about a strange person who comes from outside? It needs a golden heart. And this is why to solve your crises in your families and amongst your families and between husband and wife, children, parents and so on, you need a golden heart. Without that golden heart which has in it the belief in Allah, you're going to solve no problems. But those people, what did they do? Subhanallah, take a look. Allah says, وَالَّذِينَ تَبَوَّأُوا الدَّارَ وَالْإِيمَانَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ يُحِبُّونَ مَنْ هَاجَرَ إِلَيْهِمْ وَلَا يَجِدُونَ فِي صُدُورِهِمْ حَاجَةً مِمَّا أُوتُوا وَيُؤْثِرُونَ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ وَلَوْ كَانَ بِهِمْ خَصَاصَةٌ وَمَنْ يُوقَ شُحَّ نَفْسِهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. What a powerful verse. Wallahi, Allah is describing the heart made of gold. He says, as for those, meaning the Ansar, the helpers who were in Medina Munawwara, who opened their homes and houses and they embraced their friends who were coming, their brothers in faith who were coming through from Makkah al-Mukarramah, and they gave them preference. They loved them for the sake of Allah and they gave them preference even though they were in desperate need themselves. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, whoever can protect himself from that stinginess and from that level of wanting things for himself, if you can protect yourself from that selfishness, then you are indeed successful. A lot of us have problems because we are selfish. We want things for ourselves. If I don't get that post, I am going to continue fighting whoever gets onto the post. That's how we look at things. If I am not selected or elected, I am going to fight the person who is selected or elected. Well, only one person has to be selected or elected. And for your information, the rest of us need to acknowledge that that's what happens. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. But we become selfish. And we don't learn from the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Their hearts made of gold. Let me give you an example. Subhanallah. They were told, the Ansar were told, the people of Medina Munawwara, that these are your brothers that have come to you from Mecca. They were wealthy. They were people who owned a lot. At the moment they have nothing because everything was usurped by the kuffar of Quraysh. And what we would like you to do, O Ansar, you will open your doors. Each one will take one. We will decide who will come with each one of you. And they were so happy. They happily took through these people. Those were known as Muhajireen. If it was in our time, they would be known as refugees. Refugees. And perhaps we would have put little tents outside Medina to say that is the camp. Let us go and keep them there until the problem is solved. And they would have stayed there for years on end. But Islam says that was not the solution. The solution was something else. Embrace them. They are your brothers. The only thing is Allah chose different parents for them. Amazing. What is the link between me and you? We are the same. We are human beings. Don't you have two eyes? Well, I do too. Don't you have five fingers on each hand? Well, I do too. Subhanallah. What is the difference? Allah chose different parents for me and different for you. You did not choose, Allah chose. Why were these parents chosen? So that you and I can have a sense of belonging, so that at least we can live a life having someone around us to take care of us, and having been people who can interact with others on different levels. One of the reasons why we have family. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the understanding. So take a look at these Ansar, what they did. Half of their wealth was shared with these people as inheritance. If one person had to die, today we have a problem giving out that inheritance according to the law of Allah to our own family members. We've got an issue. Subhanallah. How many times we have people who come about and say, Sheikh, is there no way that I can block this one son of mine from inheriting? Because he has never helped me. And you look at him and you say, there are no loopholes in the Sharia. Nothing. No loopholes. You cannot do that. Maybe when you die, he will make the dua for you. We've seen it happening. Sometimes when a person dies, those who were good to him in his life, they took the money and they went. And the one who was not so good, he realized at that point, whoa, that was my dad. And he starts making dua in a way that there is greater benefit from that one. Yet the father who passed away would never have known better. Allahu Akbar. So don't underestimate the value. Those people were ready to give strangers who were brethren of theirs in the deen. Those people were ready to give them half of the wealth. They were ready to give them a share of the wealth of inheritance. But subhanallah, with us, we are so weak. We don't even know, and we don't even want to know the laws of inheritance, let alone follow them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strengthen us. So now we have Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What a powerful leader. The most powerful leader ever in existence. Subhanallah. And look at how the solution of these matters were so simple, so easy, yet they required a great sacrifice. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, those are the successful. Who are the successful? Those who can protect themselves from their own selfishness and what we would term stinginess, miserliness. If you are miserly, you won't be successful. Remember that, my brothers and sisters. If you have the selfish attitude, you will not be successful. Maybe as an individual you might see a little bit, but remember, we live on a globe. Holistically, we have a responsibility towards every other human being and all the other creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the matter was sorted, so much so that some of the companions had even offered to give much more than just half of the wealth. But those who had come from Makkah were not lazy. They too worked very hard, and in no time they saw wealth. So it was not a burden. In no time they became wealthy once again. Look at Abdurrahman ibn Auf. He was a muhajir. He was a person who came from Makkah. But what happened is, When he worked so hard, he became so wealthy that he was known as one of the wealthiest of the Sahaba رضي الله عنهم. Take a look at Uthman ibn Affan رضي الله عنه. What a powerful man. He gave so much towards the expedition of Tabuk. He is the one who purchased the well known as Bi'r Uthman. To this day, Allahu Akbar, there is a waqf in Medina Munawwara by the name of Uthman ibn Affan رضي الله عنه. To this day. Did you know that? And it has in it millions and billions. And there is a bank account with the name of Uthman ibn Affan رضي الله عنه to this day. Because Allah granted that endowment great acceptance. To this day, some of the hotels you might stay at, did you ever know that that was actually an endowment at the time made of a little garden of dates by Uthman ibn Affan? And as it passed hands over the years, did you know that they kept it as his because it was an endowment? So today we are reaping directly from the financial, economic benefits that were thought out by the will of Allah, by these beautiful, powerful people who were foresighted, who were concerned about myself and yourselves a long, long time ago, and we don't even know that. With us, sometimes we are told to donate towards a masjid or a good cause, and we find ourselves thinking, well, there are a lot of wealthy people who go to that masjid. There is no point for me to give my 5 ringgit in the box. Allahu Akbar. Maybe the blessing you will achieve by 1 ringgit that you put in the box will perhaps sort your whole life out. But we don't know. Shaitan makes us selfish. What is it? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala use us towards the right cause. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala use us to serve the correct cause. Ameen. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, at the very beginning, imagine, when he came down after what was known as the Isra and Mi'raj. You know the Mi'raj, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was taken up to the 7 heavens in person, not just in soul, in person. He was taken up to the 7 heavens. And when he returned, the people of Quraysh tried to make a mockery of him. So they went around saying, do you believe this man? He said, he's been up to the 7 heavens, Baytul Maqdis and back in one night in a short period of time. Do you know what was the answer of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu? This is when he became known as as-Siddiq, according to some narrations. This is when he became known as as-Siddiq. The truthful and the one who believed completely and immediately. When they told him, is this possible? Initially he said, no, it's not possible. They said, well, your companion, your friend, the man who you say is the messenger, he claimed it. So immediately Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu says, well, if he claimed it, then yes, it is true. Not only is it possible, it happened. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imagine, no doubt, nothing at all. Today we read verses of the Quran and the Muslimin are doubting. A'udhu billah. Look at where we are. We are talking of verses of revelation. And Muslimin say, I'm sure there must be something different there, you know, so on. Allah is telling you. Allah Himself is informing you. You have a problem? This is why we were not chosen as Sahaba. You see? The last time I spoke to one brother who was smoking like a chimney. And believe me, everyone agrees smoking is a bad habit. Brother, quit it. He says, who are you? I said, the Quran says, وَلَا تُلْقُوا بِأَيْدِيكُمْ إِلَى التَّهْلُكَةِ وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ بِكُمْ رَحِيمًا. Do not use your own hands to destroy your own selves. And do not kill yourselves. For indeed Allah is most merciful upon you. So this is a way of harming yourself. Do you know what answer he gave me? He said, well, you stop breathing. I told him, what do you mean? He says, if you breathe oxygen, 70 years later you die. It took me a second to figure that out. But I was shocked. I said, what a statement. So he's saying oxygen also contaminates your system. Stop breathing. Imagine the answer. I said, my beloved brother, we are saying it out of love. I know today we have so many people who might be smoking, but I'm still saying it with that amount of love to say, my brother, I have bad habits. May Allah make me quit them. But that doesn't mean we mustn't raise the other bad habits. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help you to quit it. Wallahi, look at the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. As soon as Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam uttered the statement, they immediately surrendered to it. I want to give you one example. There was a messenger who came in Medina Munawwara And he just made an announcement, Allah innal khamra qad hurrim. He says, behold, this intoxicating drink has been made prohibited. What did they say? They spat it out of their mouths in some instances. They threw down whatever they had. The drums that were filled with the alcohol. If it was us, we would have probably said, my neighbors are non-Muslim. Let me quickly sell this champagne to him before I actually stop from today, because I don't want to incur the loss. What they did, no. That is why they were Sahaba, radiallahu anhum. They dropped it, they blocked it, they stopped it, they threw it away, and they said, never again. I think our first point of stop would be, this guy is lying. If someone just came and made a big announcement, the first thing we would think is, this man is telling a lie. Let's go and find out. And we would dilly-dally in finding out, being worried whether it would actually be true or not. And the day we actually find out, only Allah knows what we would have done. So this is why the narration says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose the messengers. Allah chose the messengers. From all the souls, He selected the best of souls. He selected the best of souls, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And thereafter the messengers. And thereafter, the best of them after that were those of the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Amazing. Those of the companions. Why? They were prepared to surrender to what was uttered, so that when it was enshrined as law of Islam, it came down to us. Had they disputed it at the time, it would never have come down to us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them, and may He grant them an absolute reward. Another thing. Take a look at the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Not one of them called towards his or her own worship. Not a single one. Not even one. If you take a look at Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he is known as the first of the Khalifs. Did he ever say, I want you to bow down to me when you enter my palace? Did he even have a palace? That's a question. Did he ever say that I need you to worship me because I will take you to Allah? Did he ever say that? Yet he was from amongst the 10 names of those who were told in the world that you are going to paradise without a doubt. Subhanallah, it did not make him arrogant, humble. Shaitan comes to us, just because I have, mashallah, a little bit of a beard and perhaps a few people respect me and so on, so I must walk in such a way that, you know, I'm a big boss and everyone else is by the way, you know, you have to worship me, I will take you to paradise. A'udhu billah, may Allah safeguard me from those type of thoughts and all of us. Remember, I am just like you, trying to convey the message. No matter how powerful you may think the person in front of you is, that is besides the point. We all go into the same grave. And we are all in desperate need of the mercy of Allah. And we would all like paradise. May Allah unite us in Jannah. Ameen. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, one of the most humble persons ever. One of the most humble people in existence. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. I give you an example of his sacrifice. Do you know, if you were to sit with a map of the world today and put a pencil mark around the countries that were ruled by Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, you would count 35 countries of today. He ruled that whole region, the whole area. And yet, he was found sleeping under a tree. Bodyguards? Not one. Nothing. What happened? They said, oh Umar, Allahu Akbar, hakamta fa'adilta fa'aminta fa'nimta tahta shajara. You are the ruler. You rule. So you were just. Because of your justice, you felt so secure. And because of that security, you slept under the tree. No bodyguards. Can that happen? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. Today, small people have to move with bodyguards, let alone big people. That we can excuse still, mashallah. Small man. I know of some countries where any businessman, the minute he's earned his first million, first thing he has is bodyguard. Why? He just wants to walk with someone who has an earpiece. That's all. My brother, that's a fake Bluetooth that they're walking with. Allahu Akbar. If you want, I can give you 10 pieces of those. It does not increase your value in the eyes of Allah. Humble yourself down. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us humility. Learn from the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Man tawada'a lillahi rafa'ahu Allah. Whoever humbles himself down for the sake of Allah, Allah raises his status. You want raise in rank? Humble yourself. Go mix with grassroots and see what happens. Do it for the sake of Allah. Not for name and fame and pomp and glory. Do it for the sake of Allah. And see what happens. If it comes as a result, alhamdulillah, where Allah has granted you acceptance, that's the will of Allah. But subhanallah, if we do not learn from the sacrifice of these Sahaba radiallahu anhum, believe me, we have nothing in comparison to what they have. Even the wealthiest from amongst us, I think we do not equate the wealthiest from amongst them. Take a look at Abdul Rahman ibn Awf radiallahu anhu. They say he had hundreds of thousands, if not going on to the millions of dirhams and dananirs, meaning gold coins, silver coins and all that. It kept him in the first saf in salah. It kept him in the first row in salah, and not today's type of first saf, where when I read in the first saf, I think, right guys, I made it here into the first saf, you guys in the second saf, tough tacky. You did not make it. Immediately after, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. You see the guys in the first saf looking back. Why? Who came late? Let's see them. Why are you looking back? You know your salam is supposed to be just round to the shoulder, not all the way to the back. To see what's going on and who came late. Allahu Akbar. Worry about yourself. Spread the good message to the others and let them come forth at their pace, by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those companions, they were so worried. When they fulfilled their salah, they were worried about the amount of concentration they had in salah. We are not even worried about whether we read the salah or not. You see the difference? When people become regular with their salah, they are then worried about the quality of that salah. But with us, we're still struggling to become regular with the salah. But can I tell you what? At least start with that. At least start with that. Be regular. Be regular with your farad. Look at Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What a great example he was for his own companions and for all of us. You know the power that Allah had blessed him with. The spiritual power and the physical power. And the power of his companionship was such that just by looking at him with the correct heart for a moment in your life, you were transformed completely, totally transformed. You know, Abdullah ibn Salam radiallahu anhu, he was a Jewish rabbi, and he was one of the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Later on, he had studied the Jewish scriptures, and you know what he did? He shifted right to what was known as Yathrib at the time, because the description of the area fitted the description in their books as to the place where the final messenger will be coming. And he waited and he continued, and one day he heard about this man and he saw a crowd of people and he went to see who the man was. Later on he says, Wallahi, as soon as I saw the face of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the midst of the people, I knew that this is not the face of a liar. I knew that this is not the face of the liar. And I heard him say, Ayyuhan nas, afshu salama wa at'imu at'ama wa silu al-arhama wa sallu bil-layli wa an-nasu niyam tadkhulu jannata rabbikum bi salam. Wow. Oh people, spread the salam. The term salam is a broad term. It means spread peace. It also means greet people with sincerity, properly. Spread peace and feed the people, both the poor as well as perhaps relatives and the others. Feed, learn to share what you have with others, and fulfill your family relations and your ties of kinship with the others, and find yourself in prayer in the darkness of the night when everyone else is asleep, and that is how you will enter the paradise with great ease and peace of your Rabb. Subhanallah. And he says, I went to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and I declared my faith immediately. He did not think, you know what, I'm a big man in a big position, a rabbi, whether it is looked up to by so many people. In today's world, we might think, you know, I'm a big CEO of a huge company. If I correct myself, what is going to happen to my position? What is going to happen to my people? What is going to happen to the respect that I have? Sometimes you have people whom Allah has tested. They have passed their test. Sometimes we have sisters in a powerful position, and they choose to turn to Allah at least by their dress code. And wallahi, if they are from amongst those who are ready to face the challenge of that, by the will of Allah, Allah has seen them, He will grant them paradise, perhaps just by that little deed. Allah knows your struggle, my sister. Allah knows how much people have laughed at you, and Allah knows how you might have lost your worldly position just because you wanted to get closer to Allah. Remember, when you die, they will forget you anyway. How many of us can remember a person who lived 400 years ago, 200 years ago in your own family? Do you know the names? Very few would be able. You might have to go back and look at lineage, family tree. Let's look at it, subhanallah. And then you might know a name. So people will not know you at all. It will be you and your deeds. The Sahaba prepared for that. They were not worried. They lost their wealth. They lost their family members. Mus'ab ibn Umair was a man who was smelt before he was seen as a youngster. When he grew up in luxury, in the comfort of the home. He was one of the children of the nobleman, meaning a person who was wealthy. He had absolutely nothing to worry about. But when he declared, "Wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu," his own family took away whatever he had. Everything. So much so that the Sahaba radiallahu anhum wept at his point of death at the Battle of Uhud. And they said, "This was a man, we remember him wearing the best of clothing and being a person whose scent had actually such a fragrance that it was smelt before we saw him. What a powerful person he was. Today he has died, a martyr in the cause. There is not even enough cloth to cover him." So they sacrificed. They've been through worse than what any one of us could ever dream of going through. Are we ready? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. Are we ready to do what? Sacrifice a little bit to become better people, to become closer to Allah, so that when I die, I know that the world can forget me. Allah will never forget me. But if we forget Allah, Allah says, we will ensure that we forget you. Listen to what Allah says. Nasullaha fanasiyahum. Allahu Akbar. They forgot Allah, so Allah uses the words fanasiyahum, so Allah has forgotten them. Allah left them. You guys do what you want. Go. Today, you can carry on. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not do that to us. But this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, whoever comes close to Allah, Allah comes closer to him. Whoever wants to serve the cause of Allah, Allah says, we will serve their cause as well. Allah will help you when you are in need. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. My brothers and sisters, these companions were the ones who struggled and sacrificed. Look at Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu, a leader of note, a man whom Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, I'm shy of this man, meaning he has such a high level. He was the son-in-law of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not just one daughter, but when the daughter passed away, the other daughter. I want to say something just for us to take heed. Today when someone marries your daughter, mashallah, he will respect you and so on. I hope that we are still living in that type of a generation, inshallah. That they respect you, you respect them and so on. Sometimes there comes a time when you just say, I shouldn't even have given my daughter to him. Imagine if your daughter had to die. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all a good death. What would happen? In today's world, you would need to be a really golden person for the same man to offer you the other daughter. Allahu Akbar. To say, hang on, one didn't work, meaning one passed away, but we know your credentials are so high, we are happy for you if you would like to take the other daughter at this stage. Now, to bring two daughters together in Islam is not allowed. As in, if you are marrying them both at the same time, you're only allowed one of the two sisters. You're not allowed to. I hope you know that. Allah says, وَأَن تَجْمَعُوا بَيْنَ الْأُخْتَيْنِ إِلَّا مَا قَدْ سَلَفْ. It is prohibited to bring together two sisters in marriage. in a polygamous relation, if you have more than one wife, they should not be sisters. Remember that. But in this case where someone has passed away and the sister is now being brought in and all the parties are happy, I must pause there for a moment to remind you that forcing someone into marriage is haram. To force someone into marriage is prohibited in Islam. Remember that. Whether it is your daughter or your son or anyone else, there is no forcing in Islam. You cannot force someone to marry a person. No. Remember this. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us and our offspring. But the point being raised is the credentials of Uthman ibn Affan. He was known as Dhun-Nurayn because he was married to two daughters of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He had the two points of Nur. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. Look at Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu. The mountain of a man. A cousin of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the son-in-law at the same time. Allahu Akbar. I sit and I think, imagine. If your cousin wants to marry your daughter, what would happen? Allahu Akbar. May Allah protect us. Grant us an ease of understanding. Think of it for a moment. A cousin, first cousin, and a son-in-law at the same time. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a lesson. It was the credentials, the man. We are not saying do or don't. We are only saying learn a lesson. Today we reject people who are good solely because they belong to a different tribe or a different race. And we reject them because they are good. We've rejected them based on tribe and race. Not understanding that subhanallah, that is very far from the teachings of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah bless us. Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, what a great man. Yet look at the relationship he had with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his cousin, such that he was ready to give his life. What happened? At the point of hijrah, do you know what happened? The bedding of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who had taken that bedding? Yet they were planning to murder him. And Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, immediately he said, no, don't worry, I will be there, no problem. So there was a decoy that was planned and Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu was there. They risked their lives. But can I take it a step ahead? Not only risked their lives, he gave up their lives. Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib, take a look at this man, the uncle of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Can I quickly inform you of how he accepted Islam? Once he had gone out hunting and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam in the vicinity of the Kaaba was sworn and beaten by Abu Jahl, who was an enemy of Islam, also a relative of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And what happened is, when Hamza came back, someone told him, one of the maids, and told him that, you know what happened to your nephew? This is what happened. He said, what? He took his bow. You know they have a bow and an arrow hunting. He took his bow. And he went forth to Abu Jahl, and he made the famous declaration, أتشتمه وأنا على دينه أقول ما يقول. Are you insulting this nephew of mine when I, Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib? Now why is he saying I? Because he was known as a powerful figure. Nobody dare take his name, Hamza. He was the Umar of his time. Remember Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu accepted Islam after Hamza. So what had happened is, this man Hamza radiallahu anhu, when he declared that I belong to the faith of my own nephew, how dare you touch him? Amazing. After that, he made sure that he protected that nephew of his as best as he could. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam radiallahu anhum. So much so that when it came to the battle of Allahu Akbar, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease and goodness, the battle of Badr. Do you know there were 313 people who took part in that battle? And after the battle, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, at one stage in Medina Munawwara, when one of the companions wanted to admonish one of those who took part in the battle of Badr, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, leave him. وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ لعل الله اطلع على اهل بدر فقال اعملوا ما شئتم فاني قد غفرت لكم. الله اكبر. He says, leave this man. He took part in the battle of Badr. And how do you know? Allah has told the people who took part in the battle of Badr, do as you please from this day. Allah has forgiven you.
Wow.
Every time I read this type of narration, I think to myself, imagine, just as well we are not informed of paradise, because with the state of weakness of our minds, if we were informed that brother you or sister you are definitely from paradise, one wonders what would happen to the scarf, what would happen to the clothing, what would happen to the nightclubs. May Allah protect us. A'udhu billah. That is why we are not told that you have a guarantee of paradise. We are weak. When they were told you have a guarantee of paradise, it made them stronger. It made them closer to Allah. It made them more worried about the companionship of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So here comes Hamza, when he had engaged in or taken part in that battle and he lost his life. He lost his life, subhanallah. Uhud was the battle where many of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum lost their lives. But what happened? Is anyone asking you to lose your life? No. Instead, you are being asked to lead a life that is meaningful, full of the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Still, we cannot do that. Amazing. Think of it. Think of it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us learn a lesson from the lives of these Sahaba radiallahu anhum. And we've only touched on the tip of the iceberg. We've only touched on the tip of the iceberg. Believe me, my brothers and sisters, it is our duty to go through the lives of the companions. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for us. It is our duty to read their sacrifices so that we will love them and we will be able to appreciate what happened. Do you know how they dealt with difference of opinion? If we had to look into it, we would know how to deal with difference of opinion amongst us as well. Subhanallah. They always try to find out, what did Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say? What did he do? Let us ask him. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the final stopping point. And this is why Allah says, فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتِ وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. Nay, they are not true believers until they surrender to your decision in their dispute, to your ruling regarding their disputes. Nobody is a true believer until and unless he considers the solution or the ruling of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the dispute as the final ruling. And this was revealed at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for the disputes that may have taken place at the time. And Allah says, after that, true believers must not even feel in their hearts for a moment that, you know what, I've lost something. They must be happy with that decision and they must surrender completely. May Allah grant us ease. One day, سَمِعَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمَ جَلَبَةَ خَصْمٍ بِبَابِ حُجْرَتِهِ فَخَرَجْ. He heard sallallahu alayhi wa sallam some people arguing by his door, so he came out. And when he came out, he saw two people disputing over something. So he spoke to them and he told them that, look, you guys are disputing over this particular ownership of the item. And I want to tell you that I will give a ruling based on whoever presents their evidence better. Listen to this. I will give a ruling based on the evidence and whoever presents it better. Sometimes people are more eloquent. You know, you have a person who is guilty, who sometimes has a mouth that takes him out of the guilt. Like they say, this guy can talk his way out of anything, you know? And whereas you have an innocent person sometimes who really is so soft and quiet that even when people oppress him or her, they're quiet about it. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, I will give a ruling based on the evidence, but I want to tell you, if it belongs to you, alhamdulillah. If it does not belong to you, remember one thing, it is a piece of the fire. فَلْيَأْخُذْهَا أَوْ لِيَذَرْهَا فَإِنَّمَا هِيَ قِطْعَةٌ مِّنَ النَّارِ فَلْيَأْخُذْهَا أَوْ لِيَذَرْهَا. Indeed, it is a piece of hellfire. If it is not yours, you choose to take it or to leave it. Guess what happened? Both of them left the item and went away. Because they were worried, concerned. Now with us, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a lesson, and may He make us from those who take heed. Brothers and sisters, we have a history that has been beautified with great sacrifice. Great sacrifice. And believe me, the deen has come to us through the sacrifice of those radiyallahu anhum. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with them. And this is why Allah says, لَقَدْ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ يُبَايِعُونَكَ تَحْتَ الشَّجَرَةِ فَعَلِمَ مَا فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ فَأَنزَلَ السَّكِينَةَ عَلَيْهِمْ وَأَثَابَهُمْ فَتْحًا قَرِيبًا. Allah has become pleased with those who pledged allegiance with you under the tree, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, on the occasion of Hudaybiyah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, not only has He become pleased with them, but He will grant them that peace that they are searching for. He sent down to them the peace that they were searching for, and He has informed them of a near victory. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us victory. But if we would like that victory, we need to develop the link with Allah. Learn to surrender to the law of Allah. Learn to surrender to the statements of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Remember, there will always be people who try to look for an excuse to turn away from the deen, or an excuse in order to justify their wrongdoings. We should not be from amongst those. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. I've spoken for one whole hour. I hope and I pray that this lecture can be, inshallah, a stepping stone towards looking in to the sacrifice of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum and their true status, bearing in mind that it is only if we follow in their footsteps that we will be able to achieve success. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.